Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our NCERT classes. So today you have the history class for class 9th. All right. And these classes are basically useful for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination. And for that purpose, you have to read some of the basic books related to your general studies. All right. And the NCERT books are basically basic books that you must study for the preparation for the civil services examination. Apart from that, those who have already studied these books, they can also refer our channel on the YouTube for your better preparation. You can revise those NCERT books with the help of these lectures. All right. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube for your supplement, for your better preparation. These lectures are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. All right. So let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so we were basically complete. We have started the world history in our last class. Okay, so we have already finished the French Revolution in our last class. Okay, so now let's begin with the Russian Revolution. Okay, right, or the socialism that has happened in the Euro, as well as we will also focus on the Russian Revolution. So as you know that in the 17th, 18th century, right, there were the ages of the social changes. Okay, as you know that the French Revolution basically have, you know, motivated many such societies basically to have some changes in their own social strata. Okay, so French Revolution has opened up many venues for the dramatic change in the way the society is structured. Okay, so which has basically motivated certain sections of the population to change the social strata, to change the structure of the society, right? And that has ultimately led to the revolution in the societies. Okay, now, as you know that there are many people who were basically subjugated because of the regime, because of, you know, the autocratic leaders, because of some sort of a other imbalances in the society, they wanted the complete transformation. Okay, but definitely not all people, but not everyone want this complete transformation, but definitely the most of the people want some changes in the society, right? So obviously those people who have in the power, they wanted to maintain the status quo, but definitely the normal people who were not basically in among those elite classes, they wanted certain transformation in the society. Okay, now some were basically liberals, some were basically conservatives, right? So conservatives were wanted to, you know, reform the society in their own way, right? And liberals who were basically demanding the society based on the liberal principles, right? They were also radicals. So different people belongs to different ideologies. They have their own conception of the social change. They want to change the society based on their conception, based on their ideology, based on their belief system, right, in which they believe. Either they were conservative, they were basically liberals or radicals, right? So we will learn each of these individuals, right? So first of all, conservatives. So let's understand who were those conservatives. So conservative, as I told you, that they always resisted change. That means they wanted the status quo. So they wanted the status quo in the system, right? Why they wanted the status quo in the system? Because, you know, even after revolution, what they started accepting the change, but it was the slow and had links and respect to the past. So they have some sort of a superiority or some sort of the linkages with their past, right? So they want to have, right, the links and respect to the past. But they started changes, but they started accepting some changes even after revolution. But definitely they wanted the status quo to be maintained and to resist such changes. Liberals, right? Liberals are basically, you know, those people who wanted to establish the society based on the liberal principles. These liberal principles are maybe there in their religious sense. For example, they have their own views that we wanted to set up a society, the society in which every people have the equal say, right? In which every religion will have the equal standing, right? So we wanted to set up a society or set up a nation where all religions are equally promoted, right? Or the nation has tolerate every religion equally, right? There should not be discrimination based on certain aspects, right? And such type of liberals are basically focusing on mainly the parliamentary government, because such parliamentary government are having the inherent benefit, right? They were chosen, or they are chosen by the people directly, and they and those representatives who were ultimately elected, right? They were sent to the parliament, right? Those are elected. So directly elected parliamentary system, they were mainly demanded, because that were mainly focusing on the electoral system, where the electorals are or electorates are directly participating in the government formation, right? And obviously they want that, you know, we will have some sort of a well-trained judiciary. That well-trained judiciary will be allowed to have the interpretation of the laws, right? Because they want that there should be independent judiciary to for the enforcement of the law, right? And that judiciary should be independent of rulers and the officials, because they were mainly subjugating the judiciary in their own, you know, benefit. So they want the judiciary should be independent in their functioning, right? And they were not democrats in their functioning, right? Then who were radicals, right? The radicals are basically, you must understand, right? They wanted the nation in which the government is based on the majority of the country's population. For example, if the majority of the population belongs to Hindu, Muslims, or whatever may be the religious faith, right? So that government was based on the majority of the country's population. They were basically radicals, right? So they were basically disliked the concentration of the property in the hands of few, right? You know, so they were not the existence of the private property, right? So that were basically mainly demanding, right, that the government was based on the majority of the country's population, right? They were mainly, wanted reforms in such a way. So what is this industrial society and social changes that has happened? So as you know that because of industrial revolution, because of industrial development in the society, right, there was some changes in the society. So the slowly, because of economic revolution, because of economic changes, the social changes also carried away, or social changes also taken place in the society. Right now, because of industrial revolution, what happens is every section of the society, because in the industrial revolution, the factories have opened, right? You know, the automation of the work has started, the demand for the people, the demand for the labor has increased, the demand for the capital has increased. Okay, and that basically forced the industrialist or the capitalist to hire more and more workers, right? So for that purpose, the industrialists need basically like women, men, children. They were all pushed into the factories for the low wages, because at that point of the time, there was no such regulation. There were no such hard regulation, right? So they were mainly focusing, or they were mainly, you know, exploited. So the workers were mainly exploited in the hand of those industrialists, right? And most of those factory owners are basically liberals or radicals, right? And they were mainly, you know, felt that the workers' effort must be encouraged, right, in that process, because the workers are basically getting the very low wages in the society, right? Now, this has ultimately led to the socialism evolution in the Euro. So ultimately, right, the socialists were against this private property that were mainly, you know, these private properties are basically, you know, they consider that these private properties are basically, you know, are concentrating the wealth or concentrating this capitalist agenda in the hand of few people, right? So they were against totally this, you know, private property. So instead, what they want, they have different vision for the future, right? They believe in cooperatives, right, where, you know, the people were basically, you know, ultimate owner of the property, right? Where, you know, just like a corporate system where the people are basically, or the lower class people, or, you know, the proletariat will be the ultimate owner of the society, right? And for that purpose, the Karl Marx, the Friedrich Engels, they have added, you know, the industrialist society was basically a capitalist society, which were mainly exploiting the working class. So they wanted to set up a society which was ultimately led by the proletariat, right? So they were mainly you know, focusing on the society that were based on the equality, right? Where the private property do not exist. So they were totally against the private property, and they want that there should be cooperatives instead of this private property. Now, this belief has led to the support, especially from certain sections of the society in the Europe for the support of socialism. Okay. And this socialist ideas spread in the Europe, right? Through 1970s onward. Now, as I told you that this Karl Marx and, you know, the Friedrich Engels ultimately has led to the dissemination of these ideas of, you know, against this private property as having the belief in the cooperatives, and they were mainly focusing on the welfare of the workers, right? They were against those capitalistic agenda, right? So the workers in the England and the Germany, they started forming the associations. These associations, the main purpose of formation of these associations, obviously to increase or to enhance the working conditions of the workers. Because in the socialistic agenda, right, they were mainly demanding the reforms in the working conditions of the workers, because they were mainly exploited. They were having the longer hours of the working. There were very little incentive that will be provided to those workers, right? So the pathetic living conditions, pathetic working conditions, no incentives, very low wages. They were the mainly, agendas for the socialism in the society. So what happens is, you know, in 1914, there was Nicholas II, who was basically ruling the Russian Empire at that point of the time, during the First World War, where the war started. Okay. And now the Russian Empire on that time included the vast territory. Even Russia today is the largest country in terms of area, right? At that point of the time also, the Russian Empire included the very large area or very large territory that included the areas around the Moscow. That is also the current day Finland, Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, and part of Poland, Ukraine, and Belarus. Now you must understand, nowadays, these are basically independent countries, right? They are all independent countries. Right. No, some part of the Ukraine have been recently been annexed by Russia, but still the Poland, Ukraine and the Belarus, they are all independent countries. But at that point of the time, the Russian Empire also included these territories, which are now independent. OK, now let's understand what was the position or what was the condition during the Nicholas II, who were basically ruling the Russia in 1940. Right. So what was the condition in the society? So you must understand, you know, majority of the population in the Russian Empire in the 1940, right, they were mainly dependent on the agriculture. So they were mainly earning their living from the agriculture. 85% of the Russian Empire population are basically dependent for their earning on the agriculture. And there were very limited industrial development, very limited industrial setup. Right, and very few people are engaged in the basically industries. Okay, and the workers who were working, they were divided into different groups. Right, so you know they were basically divided into different groups. But whenever there is a strike, right, whenever there is a strike, so you know they did to unite to strike work whenever they were basically dissatisfied with the work. Okay. So the groupings among the workers or grouping in the workers are basically ultimately led to, you know, the process called the strike in the industrial society. Okay. And the peasants who were basically working in the agriculture, they have no respect for the nobility. Right. You know, just like, you know, the French Revolution also, where the peasants also revolted against, the basically monarch, just like that. But in the French, there were some supporters. But here, in the Russian society, in the Russian Empire, the peasants had no respect to the nobility. They were against the nobility, right? And Russian peasants were only the peasant community, right? They basically pooled their land and they basically, you know, their commune basically divided it. Ultimately, this has led to the socialism in the Europe. So, before 1940s, right? All political parties were basically illegal in the Russia, right? And in 1900, right, the Russian Socialist Democratic Labour Party was ultimately formed, right? And this Russian Socialist Democratic Labour Party, that is also known as RSC, RSDLP, this Russian Socialist Democratic Labour Party, which basically struggled, right, to give the peasants the maximum rights over their land, right? Because these lands were basically belongs to the nobles who were basically exploiting those poor peasants in their hand. So the Russian Socialist Democratic Labour Party, they were mainly focusing on the giving of the rights over the land to the peasants, right? As I told you that the land was basically divided among the peasants periodically, right? And the peasants, not the workers, would be the main source of the revolution, because the land were basically divided among the peasants periodically, and the peasants were basically felt cheated because of such periodically division of the land among them. So the peasants were the main source of the revolution, not the workers, because the peasants, 85% of the society at that point of the time, more than 85% of the society were basically earning their living from the agriculture. So agriculture, where the majority of the population was involved, okay? So their peasants were the main driving force behind the revolution, not the workers. And there were many regions, right? Some political parties were basically struggled to give the peasant their land rights, right? And obviously the land division, which has among the peasants periodically also led to the socialism in Russia. Okay, now the Lenin, who was basically also the revolutionary, he did not agree with this, and he felt that the peasants were not one social group, right? And the party, which was ultimately divided into the Bolsheviks and the Mensheviks, right? And the Lenin was basically associated with the Bolshevik group. So Lenin led this Bolshevik group. So what happens is the 1905 revolution, which is also called as turbulence time, the liberals wanted to end the autocracy of Tsar, right? So they were completely, demanding a constitution, right? That an independent constitution should be formed during such revolution that was happened in 1905. And they want to end this autocratic ruling, ruler or a monarch or as an independent ruler, as a Tsar, as institution of Tsar completely. Okay, so there was in 1904, what happens is, the essential goods, right, they were basically, basically needed for sustaining the society. Suddenly the prices of the essential goods rose so quickly. Now what happens is, but the wages of the sections of the society or wages of the workers have not been increased. Rather, the wages has declined in 1904. Now what happens is, this has led to, ultimately the dissatisfaction among the workers. And moreover, the four members of this Putilov Iron Works, which were basically, these workers were basically working, they were dismissed. And there was dissatisfaction or disagreement among the workers. So what happens is there was a call for industrial action. And that was ultimately led to the strike, which strike basically demanding, different reforms in the working conditions of the workers. So they were demanding the reduction in the working hours, because there were long working hours, 12 hours, 13 hours, 14 hours, 15 hours a day for the workers. And there was no increase in the wages of the workers. Rather, there was decrease of the real wages by 20%. So such strike ultimately led to, some reforms in the working conditions of the workers. So in the St. Petersburg, 110,000 workers started protesting, right? They were started striking, and they started demanding that there should be a reduction in the working hours and there should be increase in the wages of the sections of the workers. Okay. And what happens is, this working class, they were basically agitating or doing strike, right? They were attacked by the police and Cossacks. Now, ultimately, what happens is there was huge violence in the society, and over 100 workers were killed in the police firing, right? Because the police were also, basically supported by such industrialists. Now they have attacked on the working class with the weapons, and ultimately 100 people or more than 100 people were basically died in this process. Okay, now there were strikes took place as a reaction, different people at the different places started doing the strikes. Okay. And the people across the country started demanding the Constituent Assembly for the independent constitution, right? The institution called TASAR has allowed, right, you know, the creation of elected consultative parliament, or that consultative parliament in the Russian term is called as Duma. So TASAR, which is basically the independent institution for the independent ruler, he allowed the creation of the elected consultative parliament, just like a constituent assembly, which is formed in India. Okay. And that elected consultative parliament in Russian term is called Duma. Now, what happens is, as the Duma is formed, or as the first consultative parliament is formed after the agitation, when the people does the strikes, what happens is, as soon as it forms and started working, within 75 days, right, the first Duma was dismissed. So TASAR dismissed the first Duma, that was the first elected consultative parliament, within 75 days itself. And TASAR Institute informed or announced the election of the second Duma. Now what happens is, in this way, the TASAR also constituted the third Duma with the conservative politics. They were basically demanding the status quo. And then what happens is, there was the first war which was started. Okay. And as you know, in Russia, the First World War basically was very popular, right? And there were sections of the people which were basically supporting, right, to this First World War. And, you know, especially in the Russia, the anti-German sentiments were basically very, very high. Especially, you know, against the Germany, the people were basically very, very high, right? And as you know, the Russian army was basically lost in the First World War against the Germany and the Austria in that fight. So this First World War also affected the industrial development in the Russia. So they have also affected the industry in the Russian itself. And there were people, right, in the Russia, they were also having the anti-German sentiments with them. And obviously, with that, there was obviously the labor shortage in the society, right? And the railway lines began to break down by 1960. And the small workshops were also closed down, because on that period of the time, when the First World War, 1914 to 1981, was started. So during that time, the Russia was badly affected because of the First World War. And Russia also had the defeat, faces the defeat against the Austria and the Germany in that battleground. So there were shortage of the workshops, there was shortage of the labors, there were shortage of the grains, right? Hence, there were shortage of the bread for the purpose of eating. So there were social, the strife in the society because of shortages, right? And this has ultimately led to the February Revolution in Petrograd. So what happens is, in the winter of 1917, the Petrograd was basically very grim. Obviously, because of the food shortage, because several, you know, social infrastructure was basically completely destroyed. The railway lines were destroyed, right? There was labor shortage, right? There were people were dissatisfied. There were anti-German sentiments, right? Right. There were unstable political, you know, the system in the country. So what happens is, in that whole process ultimately led to the food shortage, specifically with the workers. So this has ultimately led to the revolution. So what happens is, on February 22nd, a lockout took place at the factory, because there was severe food shortage, right? And what happens is, in that sympathy, the other factories also joined this lockout that was started in the Russia, right, in February 22nd, you know, 1917. And this has ultimately led to the spark of this February Revolution in the Russia. Now, the women also led, you know, this strikes in the basically in certain factories. So women also led and participated in the strikes, and this has ultimately become to be called as International Women's Day. On that day, the women also started participation in the factories. And now what happens is, the government was forced to impose the curfew to stop such strikes across the country. Okay, now on 24th and 25th February, right, the government basically was forced out to call out the cavalry, right, and the police basically started keep on eyeing on them if there is any sort of strikes in the country, right? And ultimately what happens is on February 25th, the government suspended the Duma, that was basically elected parliamentary consultative, you know, that completely suspended. And the politicians also spoke against this measure, why this Duma was ultimately suspended in that process. And on February 22nd, this is a series of the events, the police headquarters were basically ransacked by the people, by the workers, by the protesters, right? And again, the cavalry was called out to stop this protest, right? An officer who was basically, you know, at the barracks of the regiment was basically shot, right? And the other you know, the regiments who were basically there, they were also mutinied, just like in our Indian freedom struggle that happens, right? And there were strikes among the workers, right? So they were, you know, the voting was started to joining the striking workers that were gathered to form the Soviet or the council, right? So ultimately, the demand for the Soviet, the demand for the council was increased, right? And this was ultimately led to the Petrograd, Soviet of Petrograd Council, right? And a delegation was ultimately formed and that went to meet the Tsar, right? And the military commanders to advise him to abdicate, right? So Tsar was advised by the military commanders to abdicate immediately because there was so much, you know, the protest, so much, you know, the violence in the society. Now what happens is, on 2nd March, the Tsar was basically abdicated. Now, the Soviet rulers or the Duma rulers, right? They were basically formed a provincial government to run the country. And ultimately, this provincial government was ultimately formed with the help of these Soviet leaders as well as the Duma leaders, right? The Duma that was basically suspended. And the Soviet leaders were those leaders who were basically joined, right, in those strikes, right, that has ultimately formed for the formation of this Soviet or a council. Now, what was the effect of this revolution? The effect was very drastic. Okay, there were restrictions on the public meetings, right, and you know, there were some restrictions on the associations that were completely removed because now ultimately they have formed, you know, the provincial government to run the country. Okay. Now, Soviets were basically set up everywhere in the society. Yeah. So, they told you that there were Syrian meetings, right? And the Soviets were basically set up everywhere. The Soviets was nothing but the councils, which were set up everywhere. Okay. Now, what happens is with the formation of this, you know, the Soviets, what happens is in the industrial areas or in the individual areas, the factory committees were also formed, right? And these factory committees were started questioning the way industrialists basically ran this, their factories, because they were mainly, you know, running those factories for the purpose of the industrial gain, for the purpose of capitalist society. So those factory committees were started demanding that there should be some reform in the functioning of those factories in the favor of the workers, right? And there were also the soldier committees that were set up in the army for ultimately purpose of giving more benefits to the society, to the workers, or to the basically soldiers, right? And the provincial government saw its power was declining and the Bolshevik influence was ultimately grow in that complete process. And now, what happens is this provincial government, when they saw that their power is declining, so they decided to take the stern measures against the spread of the discontent in the society. So what happens is their attempt to, you know, the strike down, you know, heavily on the workers were basically resisted by the workers. They were basically you know, started running the factories. And what happens is somehow the leaders were basically arrested. And the peasants and the socialistic revolutionary leaders were basically pressed for the redistribution of the land. They were mainly demand among those sections of the society, right? And ultimately, this has led to the land committee's formation. So land committee was formed and the peasants were basically started seizing the land that were there between July and the September 1917. So this has ultimately led to the revolution in the society. Now, what happens is really in the October 1917 revolution, in the 16th October 1917, right, somehow the Lenin persuaded the Petrograd Soviet and the Bolshevik party to agree to the socialistic seizure of the power. They were mainly demanding this socialist seizure of the power. So what happens in that formation, the Military Revolutionary Committee was set up. Right, this Military Revolutionary Committee was ultimately appointed by the Soviets to organize this seizure of the power specifically in the military domain. So what happens is the uprising or the violence was started on the 24th of October, right, 1917. And what happens is the Prime Minister Kerensky was ultimately left the city to summoning the troops. And what happens is these pro-government troops were sent to take over the telephone and telegraph offices and protect the winter palaces for the purpose of the revolution. And what happens is, in that response, the Military Revolutionary Committee that was set up have ordered to seize the government offices and arrest the ministers, which has ultimately led to, you know, the completely or a ship shelled the winter palaces. And, you know, the other ships also took over the strategic points, which has ultimately fall of the government, right? And by the night, the city has been taken over and the ministers were basically surrendered to the military revolutionary committees, which were ultimately ordered the seizure of the government offices and the ministers. So what happens is all the Russian Congress of the Soviets in the Petrograd, right? They approved this Bolshevik action. And, you know, the Bolsheviks completely controlled the Moscow and the Petrograd area by December 1917. And this has ultimately culminated, you know, the 1917, October 1917 revolution in the Russia. So what was the effect of this 1917 revolution? So there were very drastic effect in the society. So what happens is, after revolution, most of the industry and the banks, they were nationalized because they were mainly demanding on the socialist pattern of the society. So in November 1917, the industry and the banks were basically nationalized, right? The land were basically declared the social property because they were basically, you know, held by the nobles prior to that, but they were now declared as the social properties. And now the peasants were also allowed to seize the land of the nobility that were previously held by the nobles. Okay. And the use of old titles were completely banned. Okay. And there were new uniforms that were different from the previous uniforms, right? They were designed for the army, for the officials, for the purpose of their uses, right? And the Russia was become one party state, a communist state, right? And trade unions were kept under the party control strictly because these trade unions can also be a source of, you know, the agitations in the society. So what happens is they were completely kept under control. Okay. And there was also the civil war, right? When the Bolsheviks ordered the land distribution. Now what happens is the Russian army began to break up because they were also, some sections were also supporting, some sections were not also supporting, right? So there were non-Bolshevik socialists. There were some liberals. There were some supporters of the autocracy, right? This basically condemned this Bolshevik uprising because such non-Bolshevik socialist liberals and the supporters of autocracy, they were also not happy with the Bolshevik uprising, right? Obviously, they were supported by the French, American, British, and the Japanese troops because they were mainly supporters of, you know, the autocracy. They were condemning this Bolshevik uprising when the Bolshevik orders this land redistribution, right? And all these ultimately fought a war with the Bolsheviks. Now, what has culminated to the formation of the socialist society in the basically Russia? So what happens to the Bolsheviks who were basically, you know, propagating the idea of redistribution of the land among the peasants? So the Bolsheviks kept the industries and the banks nationalized because they were mainly the agenda of the Bolsheviks to nationalize these industries and the banks during the civil war. So they kept nationalized during the civil war. And there were rapid construction and the industrialization also started during that period, right? to make the society socialist. And the extended schooling system was also developed in the Russia in that period. Okay. And the Stalin also, you know, the towering figure, the Stalin also come into the picture. And they were also, the system of the collective farming was also started. Right. So what happens is the Stalin basically, who was basically a revolutionary leader, he believed that basically the rich peasants and the traders, right, they basically created the artificial shortage in the society. They have deliberately hoarded, they have stopped the supply, right, of the grains to manipulate the supply, to manipulate, you know, the availability of the grains in the society. So this has created ultimately the shortage of the grains in the society, right? And the collectivization is also need of the hours according to the Stalin, because this has ultimately led to the shortage of these grains in the society, right? And those farmers who were registered, this collectivization was ultimately punished or deported or exiled, who were came in between the collectivization of this land. Okay, now, obviously, in many countries, the communist parties were ultimately formed at that point of the time. So global influence of this communist parties also gained in certain sections or in the certain parts of the world. So what happens is, by that time, the outbreak of the Second World War that was started around in 1939, the USSR have given the socialism to the global face. So the socialism have given the greater weight. Even in India, our freedom fighters or the revolutionary also impacted or also influenced because of the socialism. So the socialism have given the global face and the world structure, right? It has become a basis for the social reform in the various sections of the society, right? In India also included. Okay. And by the end of the 20th century, the international reputation of the USSR or the socialist country have declined, because there was disintegration of the, you know, of the USSR, and that ultimately led to the declining of the reputation of the USSR. And that is basically, you know, starting of the Cold War. The Cold World War also was started between the two blocks. One is the capitalist block, and another is basically your socialist block or your communist block. So the socialist block is led by the USSR, and the capitalist block is basically led by the USA. So that ultimately led to the Cold World War. But that reputation was ultimately declined by the end of 20th century because of some features. All right, so that's all for today. We have completed your basically the French Revolution. Now we'll take tomorrow some other aspects of your world history. Thank you very much for attending this class. Thank you.